I will come and bow down at your feet, Lord Jesus, in your presence is fullness of joy.
Thank you for this beautiful morning in the name of Jesus Christ, rebuild and bind every foul wicked spirit to go from here right now in Jesus' name, that your word may have free course in the midst of us. And other people say, Amen. This guy dialed a wrong number and got the answering machine on. Thank you for calling, but I'm not available at the moment because I'm very busy. I'm trying to make changes in my life. I return you the call when I'm free. But if you don't happen to get a call, it could be that you are one of the changes I'd like to make in my life. We talk about building connection, trying to find the right connection, right friendship, and cultivating the right one. In our series, Building Bridges, we touch on the Maslow's level of need. Look at the triangle, we've done three key. One, which is self-actualization, which is to fulfill your highest destiny in our context, will be to fulfill God's destiny for us. And then esteem. One of the key reasons marriage breakdown is not because of a third lady or a third man. It's because the lack of respect shared among the couple. And of course, friendship is the third deepest need. And today we're going to touch on friendship. Loneliness is a crisis in our society, and the simple fact that those songs that are most popular are songs that touch on loneliness. Watch. University did a study quite recently and found a direct connection between the feeling of loneliness and your health. In fact, it kills as much as smoking or alcoholism. And the University of York did a study and actually increases the rate of heart failure and stroke by 30%. That's how bad loneliness can be. And the Bible talks about isolation. Living in isolation can be demonic. In other words, you always keeping to yourself, it could be under the influence of demon. Remember the guy that was possessed by a legion, 5,000 demons. He was isolating himself from the rest of the community. He was hiding in the cemetery, lost his hope, lost his passion, cutting himself, destroying himself. So today we'll touch on how to build good friendship. And we got to be friendly to all, but there are certain levels of friendship. Even Jesus had three disciples, and they have 12 and 144. So We got to learn how to not just cultivate friendship, but find the right friends. And friendship is not something which is accidental. It's something that you get to cultivate, you have to cultivate. And firstly, we touched on it a couple of weeks ago, you got to choose the right friends. Proverbs 12, verse 26.
A righteous man is cautious in friendship, but the way of the wicked leads them astray.
Wow, how many of us know the way the wicked lead us astray? You recall 3 million people, 2 million plus children and women, would be about 3 to 4 million, were led astray by only 10 of the negative people among the 12 spies. And they, as a result of hearing all the negative thing, they don't want to go and possess the land. They were not listening to Moses, their leader, that we can possess the land. Why? Because they were listening to the negative. And so it led them astray. And sometimes when you hear all kind of negative words, be very careful, very subtly. You get upset with the very people that could be the key to you fulfilling your highest destiny. And why are we cautious in friendship? Proverbs 22 verse 24 says,
"Do not associate with a man given to anger, or go with a hot-tempered man, lest you learn his ways and find a snare for yourself."
So be friendly to all, but your inner circle, all the time you're spending time with them, critical, bitter, angry, lazy, how many of you are lazy, envious, and not honest, as a matter of time, you will become exactly like these people. So first and foremost, you've got to get the right friend. Good friends are not accidental. You've got to cultivate. How do we cultivate it? We talk about the five key elements from the book of Proverbs. We've done three, which is a bit of a recap. Number one, you've got to be committed to be loyal. Proverbs 3:3. Never let loyalty and kindness leave you. Tie them around your neck. So that is very important. Write them deep within your heart. Then you could find favor. How many of you like to have favor with God and man and have good reputation? Never let loyalty leave you. So watch this clip, Jody.
What were you and Jody talking about in the kitchen earlier? Seems kind of important.
Yeah, Kimmy, I messed with her and she was pissed at me. Okay, so she came over here the other day and she was saying that the reason that she left the escape room was because she couldn't stand to see me with somebody else.
So anyways, I couldn't get her to leave, so...
Just to get her off my back, I said, yeah, I'll meet up with you tonight, we can talk more about it. But I totally stood her up.
Oh, babe. My guy.
It's a vibe, bro.
Hey! What's your problem, man?
You are, man. You are. When I met you, you were genuinely a super nice guy, man, but you've turned into such a jerk.
And look, you're talking trash about Jody to all these people in public.
But when we're in private, man, the crazy thing is you don't even know a thing about her, man. What's her birthday, huh? What's her middle name? What's her favorite color? What color are her eyes, man? I mean, Jody has so much to offer. She's the best person that I know.
I bet you didn't even know. She's reading the list of 100 best books before she turns 21. Did you know that?
And that's what's so funny, is you think you're so much cooler than her, but you're not. You guys, none of you guys are. You think she is so much cooler than all you guys combined.
Loyalty is so important. Rick Warren said, the real friend walks in when everybody else walks out. And the kidding is, we kind of put that loyalty on our necks. Having said that, friendship is so important. It fulfills the third level of our need. You look up the Maslow's levels need, but the number one need is self-actualization. In other words, to fulfill your destiny. So this is why we encourage young people when they go overseas to study for church. Don't go there because of friends. Don't go there because the music is hype. Make sure. Yeah, it's good to have hype music, strong, vibrant. Make sure it is Christ-centered, blood-centered, Christ work-centered, and word-centered. Otherwise, you're going to feel very empty, and you're going to be very dry. After a while, the excitement wanes off. The most important, number one area of need is self-actualization, which is to fulfill your highest destiny. That's the reason why. Choose a place where you can grow. Planted in the house of the Lord, Psalm 92 verse 13, you flourish in the courts of the Lord. One of the most important soil and environment for growth is that make sure it is a place where grace is preached 100%. Watch this Chinese saying from Pastor Kerry.
橘生淮南则为橘，生于淮北则为枳.
There's a river called Huai River, the fourth longest river in China, in between the north, the Yellow River, and the south, Yangtze. And very strange thing. The same mandarin oranges planted in the north is bitter orange, but the south are sweet mandarin. Same soil, same seed, but different soil, different environment causes that. So the same way is important. If your kids are called to a certain area, make sure that they have the same environment. Like the prophetic mandate that God has given to us. If you look up, you can also have the card with you. And the prophetic mandate, what church, kind of a church, it will develop the kind of a fruit. Like Fountainhead Church, where entrepreneurs are being raised, being prayed for, being empowered. That is kind of a soil and environment that we're going to take off. Center of Davidic worship that is Christ-centered, word-centered, and blood-centered. It's not just about hip music, it's about Christ. A revival among young people and miracle healing harvesting place. In this 38th year anniversary, we believe that God is going to accelerate the fulfillment of all this prophetic mandate, and don't miss it. And the first thing is to get into a soil and environment where all this can take shape. And then from there, you build friends. And all these characteristics of what a friend ought to be is fulfilled in Jesus Christ. How many of us know that Jesus Christ is our true friend? Because the John 13 verse 1 tells us, He loved us to the end. On the night that He was betrayed, He took bread and gave it to the disciples and said, take and eat, it's my body broken for you. When we are at our worst, Jesus gave the best for us. So Jesus is loyal to the very end. Number two key to build in friendship is trustworthy to keep confident. Proverbs 11 verse 13.
A gossip betrays a confidence, but a trustworthy man keeps a secret.
Now sometimes we don't mean it. Sometimes we don't have a bad motive. But being careless in our words can be a form of betrayal. It's noted here in Proverbs 11 verse 10. Sometimes you don't mean it, but because you're careless in your words, your friend invited you for a birthday party and you're just carelessly telling everybody, and those who are not invited will be very angry with your friend. It is not that you have a bad motive. Maybe you're excited, but because you're not thinking, you can cause a lot of damage, and it breaks that trust. And of course, that got to be earned. You notice Jesus Christ, He's not the type that loved the exposed things. It was a Pharisee, remember, brought the woman caught in a very act of adultery. But Jesus helped the lady by saying, neither do I condemn you, go and sin no more. And in that context, He said, I'm the light of the world. Light not to embarrass. It was a Pharisee that exposed us. Light to take us the way, the right way, the way out of the darkness. So the second key to build cultivated friendship, got to be trustworthy to keep confidence. If you are a type of person that cannot keep your mouth closed, people won't tell you things. And that is going to affect your relationship. Number three, be kind and gracious. Proverbs 19:22 say, what is desirable in a man is kindness. You gotta be handsome, you wanna be beautiful, gotta be kind. And the opposite of kindness is Proverbs 11:12.
A man who lacks judgment derides his neighbor, but a man of understanding holds his tongue.
What do you mean to deride? It means to show no respect, it means to despise, it means to contempt, to spite, to say negative things. And a kind person will never talk negative in front of you or behind you. But we're going to watch out people that are very, very sweet in their words, because Proverbs 26 verse 23 say, smooth words may hide a wicked heart, just as a pretty glaze covers a clay pot. People may cover their hatred with pleasant words, sweet words, but they are deceiving you. They pretend to be kind. Don't believe them. Their hearts are full of many evil. You notice it was a mixed multitude of people. They don't really flow with the vision of Moses. They just came along. They laid on the yen for the garlics and onions of Egypt. They were not loyal. They were not committed to Moses' vision. And that led the 2 million or 3 million people miss out their destiny. But sometimes these people are good people that somehow get distracted. Like, remember Paul was in prison. He said perhaps in tears, Demas, having loved the world, have forsaken me. Demas had begun well, but distracted by the world, left Paul in the hours of his greatest, deepest need. And the same way Jesus drove off the money changers and all the buying and selling. Why? Because they were distracted and they missed the day of visitation. So then how could we develop the kind of a friendship that will be kind and gracious? Proverbs 17 verse 9 says,
he who covers over an offense promotes love, but whoever repeats the matter separates close friends.
Now, it doesn't mean we cover up our sins. You can see that we've got to be honest with our friends in giving feedback. It doesn't mean to cover up, sweep everything under the carpet. It means to cover the weaknesses with His grace. Like the way that Jesus dealt with Zacchaeus. I mean, the the world, the people look at Zacchaeus as a corrupted tax man. But Jesus called up Zacchaeus by his name. Nobody called him by that name. Everybody called him by that nickname. Corrupted tax man. But Jesus looked at him and said, Zacchaeus means pure and innocent. You know what? That word that Jesus spoke lifted Zacchaeus up to what he can be, and he became a radically transformed man. So you're going to be friends, you got to cultivate that kind of friendship, got to be committed to be loyal. Jesus loved us to the end. Jesus, you can see that character of what a friend should be like in Jesus. Trustworthy to keep confidence. He's a light not exposed and embarrassed. He's kind and gracious. And not cover up, but cover us with grace. The next 2 points that I want to highlight today is be honest but not harsh. Proverbs 15 verse 4.
Kind words bring life, but cruel words crush your spirit.
Now, if you're kind, you're not going to be cruel in your word. And sometimes we can be very subtly cruel. I just learned it quite recently from Psychology Today. And it is a description of 10 things that passively aggressive people say. I never heard of that term. Passively aggressive. How many of that? Passive aggressiveness. What is passive aggressiveness? It's basically hidden hostility, a way of saying negative and sarcastic things but avoiding direct confrontation. For example, the 10th thing that is mentioned, you dress nice, but isn't it a style from last year? You done well for someone with your education level. Don't worry, the next one, very passively aggressive person. There are a lot of lady out there that love chubby men. Another form of passive aggressiveness is giving excuses to justify work that is undone. Hey boss, I'm not trained for this. I don't know how to do it. Now, there's no excuse I don't know how to do. Today we just Google. Say the other right, just Google. Another passive aggressive excuse is nobody told me. I've seen people like that. Have you read that group chat? I didn't. But it's written there. You read. Oh, I read it. It's true. But I didn't notice it. So we can give all kinds of excuses. And the job that we don't like doing, we say, oh, boss, it's not in my job scope. Oh, boss, I have too many things to attend to. Hey, the truth is that you have time for all the things that you are passionate about. Come on, even in the busy schedule, you plan for your holiday, right? You get the best hotel, the best airline. And when you're passionate about something, you'll find time. And I don't know, giving excuses is actually a form of passive aggressiveness until I read this. And why is it passive aggressiveness? Could be that we are throwing the buck back to the boss. And sometimes we can be blunt and causing people hurt, and we give the excuse. In another form of passive aggressiveness, I'm blunt, but I don't mean it. I'm just joking. You know, the Bible in Proverbs tells us that people that say something and they don't mean it, the Bible calls it worse than fools. Proverbs 29, verse 20.
There is more hope for a fool than for someone who speaks without thinking.
So you hurt somebody and say, I don't mean it. In other words, you speak without thinking. And the Bible says, more hope for a fool than someone who do that. So, Pastor, I don't mean to hurt. I'm just joking. I'm just in sport. Bible says, madman. Proverbs 26, verse 18.
Like a madman shooting deadly burning arrows is the one who shoots at a neighbor and then says, I was just joking.
So, be honest, but not blunt. Honest to keep our words. Psalm 15, verse 4.
Keep your word even when it costs you.
You know, it used to be that signing contracts those days is just a shake hand, and my word is my bond. Nowadays, we have the lawyers to put in all the agreement, all the small print. Hey, how much though? My word is my bond. Have you ever made promises and you don't mean it? I'll come in 5 minutes. Actually, you meant come in 5 hours. Thought about you lose respect with your words. Especially with kids. Oh, son, I'm taking you hiking one day. But the son has been waiting every day, and it never happened for the last month. Eventually, you lose respect. Ecclesiastes 5 verse 5.
It is better not to vow than to make a vow and not fulfill it.
5, 6.
Do not let your mouth lead you into sin, and do not protest to the temple messenger, my vow was a mistake. Why should God be angry at what you say and destroy the work of your hands?
Sometimes we make rash vow. Pastor, what is a rash vow? Well, something which is unthinking, perhaps emotional, and impetuous. In the Bible, there's a sad story of a guy named Jephthah. He's a great deliverer for the people of God, delivering them from the people of Ammon, the Ammonites. But he made a rash vow. He said, if you got a victory, the first person come out of the house to greet me, I'm going to sacrifice the person as a burnt offering. And the first person that came forward was his own daughter. And a rash vow. But the Bible has a provision of grace to get us out of the rash vow. How many months of the Old Testament is not just law? It is also intertwined with grace. And God has a provision for that, Leviticus 27, verse 8.
If you desire to make such a vow but cannot afford to pay the required amount, take the person to the priest. He will determine the amount for you to pay based on what you can afford.
But if you make a rash promise, one of the key ways not to break it but to get the grace way out of it is to see your pastor and get a counseling and do whatever that is needed to be done. In fact, in Numbers 30, the same with the woman who make a vow. Without the husband's endorsement, or a married lady without the father's endorsement, Bible tells us that he can go to the dad or the husband and to find a way out of it. And the Bible tells us in Numbers 30, verse 5, that the Lord will forgive her because of her father would not let her fulfill them. So God has a grace way. So honest to keep our word, honest in our words. Deuteronomy 25, verse 15.
Yes, always use honest weights and measures so that you may enjoy a long life in the land the Lord your God is giving you.
Now, long life, like eternal life, doesn't mean long, long. It means also the abundant life. In other words, if we are dishonest, if we are dishonest with our word, it's going to affect us enjoying the abundant life that God has for us. Like what Pastor Joseph Prince used to say, he can tolerate any idiosyncrasies among his staff. But one thing he can't tolerate is lie and keep lying. And sometimes we don't lie in our words, sometimes we lie in our action. I remember years ago, I was in Finland, and they put me, Pastor Kerry and myself, in the house of this particular widow, and we enjoy the food there and the hospitality, except that we find the apple a little bit weird. And later on, I was told actually she got it from the street, from the dustbin. And, well, if she really cannot afford it, I can tolerate. But later on, I was told actually she was a rich widow. So what happened is that she has that kind of a spirit of poverty that she always, not by words, but through her action, try to convey that she's really that poor. I don't know what is the reason. Could be that he doesn't want to give. Could be also that she wanted more. Like, she has great inheritance, but she project that she is, but she don't really get to enjoy the wealth that she inherited. So, actually robbing herself, because life and death in the power of the tongue, including our action. And Proverbs 14, 15 tells us, simpleton believe everything they're told. So you're going to be discerning. And kidding, how do we detect people that are dishonest in their words? Proverbs 10, 19.
When there are many words, transgression is unavoidable, but he who restrains his lips is wise.
So when we talk too many things sometimes, our words do not tally, and we don't even know that we are lying. And so be honest to keep our word, honest in our words, and honest to give feedback. Proverbs 24, verse 26.
An honest answer is the sign of a true friendship.
Proverbs 27, verse 5.
Better is open rebuke than hidden love. Wounds from a friend can be trusted, but
if
an enemy multiplies kisses.
Wounds from a friend can be trusted, but enemy multiply kisses. And I think it was this Greek philosopher by the name of Plutarch who said, I don't need a friend who changes when I change, who notes when I note. And he says, my shadow does that much better. So we want friends that are honest enough to give us honest feedback, but in the kind way, like Matthew 18, verse 15, you've find somebody that give you a bit of a problem, you should go to him directly one-to-one to win a brother. Sometimes people came to me complaining about certain individual. I say, apply Matthew 18. And when I do that, don't say, Pastor, say, I come to talk to you. Say, Jesus said, because it was Jesus who said in Matthew 18, go and talk to the person. And ultimately, the purpose is to win a brother. And for our part, we've got to be open to receive the feedback, honest feedback. Proverbs 28, verse 13.
He who covers his sins will not prosper, but whoever confesses and forsakes them will have mercy.
But yes, it's true that we give honest feedback. We've got to give the feedback and speaking the truth in love. Paul tells us in Ephesians 4, 15, speaking the truth in love. How do we speak the truth in love? Very simple key. I said it many times. You correct in private, but compliment in public. One of the fastest way to lose friendship is just to correct people in public, especially husband and wife in front of children. And do not be over familiar. In the notes I put down, I'm sure you know, familiarity breeds contempt. But I also add something which you may not know. Proximity does not mean familiarity. So, Pastor, I'm very close to him, I can be blunt. That's assumption. Put yourself on the receiving end. You notice it is not so nice. So you correct in private. Yeah, and just because you're close, you think you're close with that person, it doesn't give you the authority to be blunt. And you correct, of course, in your notes, at the appropriate time. Not the entrance. Try to correct your husband when it's at the entrance and you get a bad day and hungry. Choose the right timing. And speak out of love. Don't rebuild out of anger. Just to fulfill your passion, to release your steam, so to speak. You recall when Jesus drew the money changers and also the buyers and traders of doves and animals. Some people thought he was very upset and angry. Look at the context. He was weeping. He was crying. It was a rebuke of love because they missed the time of their visitation. And so to be good friends, you've got to be committed to be loyal, trustworthy, to keep confidence, kind and gracious, honest, but not harsh. Lastly, take the initiative. Proverbs 19, verse 24.
Lazy people take food in their hand, but don't even lift it to their mouth.
How many people like that? They're so lazy. They don't take initiative. Matthew 7, verse 12.
Ask yourself what you want people to do for you, then grab the initiative and do for them.
Say, grab the initiative. In other words, number one, be the first to act. Pastor, he is harsh to me. I'm going to be harsh to him. Then you become the common. But God called us to be uncommon. Pastor, he criticized me. I'm going to finish him off. Then you become just like him. Huh? He's rude to me. I'm going to be rude to him. You just stoop to that person's level. Pastor, my brother is kind. Then I'll be kind. If you smile, then I'll smile. If my spouse change, then I'll change. Then you have become a thermometer. Remember, no, God didn't call us to be thermometer. God called us to be a thermostat. You set the passion. You set the temperature. Proverbs 19, verse 22 tells us,
friendliness bear fruit for a man.
In other words, when you are friendly, you're going to bear fruit. You will want the kind of a friend that is loyal, trustworthy, kind, honest. You be that kind of a person first. And you do it first. You take the initiative. Don't say, one day. Do it now. Be first to say, I'm sorry. First to smile. First to write a thank you note. First to praise. First to talk. All right, watch this clip. How kids make friends.
Start with a hello.
Get them to introduce themselves, then you introduce yourself.
If they don't have a friend, just go to them and say hello.
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 Hey yo, my name is Dickie.
I would just be like happy or just smile like this.
I would say, what's your favourite toy?
Ask them what your name is.
You could say, don't I make friends?
You ask a bit about themselves.
You get it football.
Yeah, pretty good.
You just need to listen. It's kind of nice to listen to everybody when you're talking.
When you're making friends, make sure you're really kind and polite.
Okay.
I just make sure everyone has to give the ball.
You just share it, so you give it to them and you take turns.
Just ask them, will you want to play with me?
Now I make sure they join in by playing a different game that they'll like.
We draw together.
I would just say, join in if you like.
Share your lunch, like sandwiches, like a cheese. And you can share my lunch if you want.
I share everything. I share all the toys.
Sharing toys are important because if you do share the toys, they'll get happy.
So we learn from the kids. Jesus said, learn from the children, for such belong the kingdom of God. And one of the key things our kids taught us just now was share. Proverbs 11:24, give freely and become more wealthy. Be stingy. How many are stingy? And loses what? Everything. Like we shared to you, the Finnish lady, she didn't really enjoy the rich wealth that she has because she's trying to communicate to people that she's poor. And she actually cursed herself and didn't really enjoy. Verse 25, the generous will prosper, those who refresh others will themselves be refreshed. Another translation, the Message translation, say, the well of the generous gets larger and larger. In other words, when a person is generous, it's not just going to get back their money in return. Your well, your exposure is going to be enlarged. You're going to be able to see, you're going to have big vision. Like this new series in the Kingdom classes, beginning February, one of the key is developing bigger vision. So if you're a very stingy kind of a person, your vision is not, you cannot enlarge your vision when we are not generous. Verse 25, the one who blesses others is abundantly blessed. And so take the initiative, all right? Be the first to act and go the extra mile. Jesus said that in Matthew 5:41. And here is the context of, there's a provision under Roman law. The Roman soldier asks you to carry his luggage for 1 mile. There's a requirement, but Jesus said, hey, go, get, carry an extra mile. And this is the saying, go the extra mile. Someone told me this particular story. I'll just pass it to you. I mean, let's call this two guys. Peter and John, they graduated from university, they joined a firm, same time. And after 2 years, John got promoted, but Peter was not. And Peter was rather hurt, jealous, but he continued working a few more months. And a couple of months later, he sent in a letter to resign to his manager. And he said, this company doesn't value hardworking people and practices favoritism. And that manager is a good guy. He wanted Peter to know why. What was his problem? He told Peter, can you go, I believe this is a food industry company, go and get melon. Find out about how much we get for 1 melon. Peter came back, short while. Oh, boss, melons, I got one guy, and he sells for $13 per kg. And in the presence of Peter, he asked John to go. And John didn't know that Peter came back with the report. John took off. And came back, and he said, sir, I found a guy in the town that sells watermelon, and it costs $50 for one. If you buy 100 melons, they will sell you for $30, inclusive of delivery. The melons are excellent quality, sweet, fresh, and red, and they were sliced for us for free. And if we cut the deal by today, you will save $2,000 in 1 month, and here is a spreadsheet typewritten to give you an overview. Boss awaits your decision. And when Peter heard what John has done, he knows the reason why he was not promoted. He doesn't stand out. He doesn't do the extra mile, and in your notes I put down, when you find someone else doing better, don't complain. Say to the person on the right, don't complain. It is not what we do, but how we do that makes the difference and stands out. It is doing the extra mile that brings us the reward. So when Jesus asks us to do the extra mile, it's not for our the Roman soldiers' benefit, it's for our benefit, because it's going to make us stand out. And one form of passive aggressiveness I'll show you just now from Psychology Today is giving excuses for job not done. Now, I didn't know that excuses can be a form of a passive aggressiveness, because it's like throwing the buck back to the boss. Boss, it's not in my job scope. Boss, I'm too busy. Meaning, boss, you're giving me a lot of work already. And the fact is that the truth is that we can do anything we are passionate in doing. Proverbs 22 verse 29.
Do you see a man who excels in his work? He will stand before kings. He will not stand before a known man.
If I put it in the opposite, do you see a man who excels in his excuses? He will stand before the unknown. He will not stand out in anything that he does. So initiative is very important. You want to have friends that take initiative. We got to take the initiative. As you cultivate that kind of friendship, we're going to get a lot of friends that are going to take initiative, even in relationship to us. Initiative to do things without being told. And the Pharisees asked Jesus, who is my neighbor? It's like saying, who's my friend? Jesus told them a story of a guy that came from the holy city down to Jericho, robbed and injured by the robber. And a priest and a Levite walked past. Didn't do anything, because the law didn't say, help an injured person. How many of us know? We got to go beyond what the law required. And it was a Samaritan guy who saw that guy move with compassion, passion. That's it. We can give all kind of passive aggressive reply. I'm too much work. Pass the buck back to the boss. The fact is that when we are passionate in anything, we will do it. The Bible tells us this Samaritan guy was passionate. He has compassion and he take the initiative. Go the extra mile. Go beyond what the law required. Go beyond job scope. Go beyond job description. I got to do this, man. Go beyond what is required. And you know what? Cleanse the wound and put it on his donkey. What does that mean? It means this guy, Samaritan, will have to walk the rest of the journey. Not only that, at the inn or the hotel, he paid for all the hotel expenses. He said, and I come back, I pay whatever that other expenses that is incurred. What a beautiful picture of Jesus Christ. He took the initiative. He came down 2,000 years ago, be the best of friend. He paid for all our debts. You notice in Psalms 5:16 says, yes, he is altogether lovely. He is the perfect friend. You want to be what a friend is like? Look at Jesus Christ. This is my beloved, song say, and this is my friend. Committed to be loyal, trustworthy to keep confident, kind and gracious, honest but not harsh, taking the initiative. He came all the way. John 15:12.
This is my commandment. Love each other in the same way I have loved you. There is no greater love than to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command.
So, Pastor, but I'm by nature not the kind of outgoing type. Nobody asks you to be outgoing. Jesus said, just be friendly. And it's not about our nature. It's not about how I'm born like that, it's I'm like that. It's a command. The only answer we can give is, yes, sir, I'll be obedient. Hammerman said, God wants us to be friendly. Our vision for this church is that RLC will become one of the most friendly churches in the Klang Valley. And other people say, why? Romans 15:7 say,
so warmly welcome each other into the church, just as Christ has warmly welcomed you, then God will be glorified.
So coming Sunday, the family day, the opportunity for us to apply friendship. Take initiative to reach out to host people. And you got to be aggressive in our hosting. Matthew 11 verse 12 says, from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven has been forcibly advancing, and forceful man lay hold of it. The word forceful is to surround, besiege. And so apply this coming Sunday to make RLC the most friendly church. Say together with me, we're going to make RLC the most friendly church in the Klang Valley. And other people say, they of course join a connect group to be connected with friends that in the process of developing the characters that we have highlighted. And Jesus Christ is altogether lovely. You talk about the character of friends that we want to have, it's all fulfilled in Jesus Christ. He is so awesomely great. We talk about the greatness of God. Very often we look at, wow, man, he's so powerful. He made the stars, made the heavens and the earth. When the Bible talks about greatness, it's always focused on the greatness of his love. The Bible tells us there's no greater love than to lay down one's life for one's friend. And God says, he laid down his life for us. He's great in his love for us. Don't try to be friendly on your own strength. The more we focus on Jesus, the more we receive his love, the more you're going to see that you're going to be the friend that you want to cultivate and become friends to others. I wonder how many of you today do not know Jesus Christ. And you may be born in the Christian home, but you don't know Jesus Christ. And say, Pastor, pray for me. I want to receive Jesus into my heart. Would you pray this prayer together with me? Dear Father, thank you for sending Jesus to die for my sin. I receive Jesus to be my Lord and Savior. Thank you, Jesus, for restoring my integrity. Thank you, Lord Jesus, as we behold you, see you, we're going to be transformed from one level of glory to another, from one level of kindness, chesed, to another level of kindness. Thank you, Jesus, from changing me inside out. Amen, amen.